Welcome to the last lecture of the module on Bitvector Data Flow Frameworks. In this lecture, we want to take a look at the anticipable expressions analysis. Again, this lecture is going to be short. We will simply look at the need for this analysis and the data flow equations. There are two tutorial problems, and we will conclude this lectures in this module by comparing the Bitvector frameworks that we have seen so far in this module. So what is an anticipable expression? An expression E is considered to be anticipable at a program point P if every path from P to program exit contains an evaluation of E which is not preceded by a redefinition of any of the operands of E. Note that this is just a dual of available expressions analysis. In available expressions analysis, we again talked about every path. This is also an every path problem. But in available expressions analysis, we talked about every path from start to P. In this case, we are talking about every path from P to program exit. So this is a dual of the path. And because in available expressions analysis, we talked about every path from start to P, we said the expression should not be followed by a definition of any of the operands. Here we say an expression should not be preceded by a definition of any of the operands. The idea is that in case of both the problems, we are saying if we were to place a computation of expression E at a program point P, would it be same as in case of available expressions, we say previous computation of expression E along every path. In case of anticipable expression, we say the following computation of E along every path. That's the only difference. Otherwise, this is similar to available expressions analysis. So available expressions analysis was a forward data flow framework. Anticipable expressions analysis is a backward data flow framework, because the data flow information at a program point is discovered from the data flow information at the successor program points. Why is this useful? This is useful for safety of code placement. So let's look at this example. Here we have this computation of A divided by B, which is done provided B is not zero. There's an optimization called code hoisting, which tries to move expressions out of a loop and above the loop so that the expressions can be computed only once. Multiple instances of expressions are combined into one. Multiple instances of same expression are combined into once. So we would like to ask whether it is always safe to do so. In this case, it is easy to see that if we were to move this expression from here to here, and what is the meaning of moving this expression from this point to this point? The meaning of moving this expression from this point is that we store here T is equal to A divided by B and use that variable T here. So if we were to do that, we observe that if we move this expression here, which means that this is computed before this check, because after the check we do a control transfer. And if it is, because it is computed before this check, it means that the division happens always even when B is zero. And this changes the behavior of the optimized program. The unoptimized program will not raise this exception because the division happened here. In the optimized program, the division is happening here. So regardless of whether which branch is taken, if the value of B is zero, the optimized program will raise an exception, whereas the unoptimized program would not have raised an expression because it would not have evaluated A divided by B if B were to be zero. So we require that this expression should be computed along every path for it to be hoisted in a basic block above. So for example, in this case, we have A divided by B here and A divided by B here. And the idea is that we can safely replace A divided by B here. Of course, one could argue that the situation is similar here. Once again, we will raise an exception. But the point is, in this case, it is safe to raise an exception because the exception would have been raised here in the original program anyway. So which means that even if B were to be 0, this expression A divided by B would have been evaluated. So the essential idea is that a guarded computation of an expression should not be converted to an unguarded computation. By a guarded computation, we mean a conditional computation, a computation that's happening depending upon a condition, and the condition is also called a guard. So when that condition is true, only then the expression evaluation is done. Such a computation is called a guarded computation of an expression. If we do not do anticipable expressions analysis, we might end up converting a guarded computation of an expression into an unguarded computation. So the idea is we should be able to place an expression at the program point P where it's originally not there, only if we know that every path from that program point onwards, that expression evaluation happens. How do we define data flow analysis for anticipable expressions analysis? Once again, we define the set gen, we define the set kill, and it's easy to imagine what these sets would be. The set gen contains those expressions that are evaluated within the basic block n, and this evaluation is not preceded within the block by a definition of any operands of E. Note that this gen is what was called ant gen or gen for anticipability when we talked about redundant computations in common sub-expression elimination using available expressions analysis. So the idea is, if I have an expression within a basic block and it is not preceded by a definition of any of the operands, then I can push this expression out to the entry of the basic block. Similarly, in order to decide which are the expressions whose anticipability is killed, it's very easy. The idea is that any expression whose operands are defined within a block, the block in that situation kills the anticipability of the expression. The data flow equations are a dual of available expressions analysis. Like available expressions analysis, we use the intersection here, except that in the case of available expressions analysis, we computed in as intersection of out of the predecessors. Here we are computing out as the intersection of in of its successors. And if it's an end block, we use boundary information. In case of available expressions analysis, we use boundary information if n was the start block. And in n is computed from out n by removing those expressions whose anticipability is killed and adding those expressions that are generated, whose anticipability is generated, and in and out are sets of expressions. So by now we have seen that these data flow equations have a common template. There are some minor variations. Here are a couple of tutorial problems for anticipable expressions analysis, and I will not work out these examples in details. I mean, the solutions are there on the slides, but I will not explain them on the slides. Here we have expressions A star B, B plus C, and B minus C. So we use a bit vector of 3 bits, and here are, we have gen and kill sets here. And we find that we have the basic block N generates the anticipability of B plus C and E star B, A star B. So therefore the first two bits are 1 here. The third expression is not anticipable. So its bit is 0, and anticipability of no expression is killed. So it is 0, 0. So this is how we have gen and kill sets. And then in the iteration, in the first iteration, we have these values. In the second iteration, we find these values change. And I will leave it for you to work it out and find for yourself that these are indeed the results that we get. There's another tutorial problem with just 2 expressions, and I will leave it for you to work it out. So that is all that I wanted to explain for anticipable expressions analysis. And now we want to look at the common features of Bitvector frameworks. There are several things that are similar. So we looked at live variables analysis, and we talked about a variable. And for generation, we talked about the use of a variable. For kill, we talked about the modification of the variable. And the use of the variable for generation must be upwards exposed. For kill, it doesn't matter whether it is followed by or preceded by anything. For analysis of expressions, we talked about available expressions analysis and anticipable expressions analysis. In either case, we talked about expressions. In either case, we talked about use or evaluation of an expression, and kill was based on modification of the value of an expression, which amounted to finding a definition of any of the operands of the expression. And for generating availability, we wanted the use to be downwards exposed, which is the evaluation should not be followed by a definition of any of the operands within the basic block. For anticipability, we want upwards exposed evaluation, which is the evaluation should not be preceded by a definition of any of the operands of the expression. For killing, the availability or anticipability, all we wanted was that some operand should be defined somewhere within the block. It didn't matter what it was preceded by or followed by. And now we find that there is a common form of data flow equations where we write the data flow variables as xi and yi. So we have xi is some function of yi, and yi is, this is the operator that we use to denote a confluence, and yi has been computed from some xj. These could be in or out depending upon the situation. So these are the variables representing data flow information. So far we have seen that these variables represent sets or bit vectors, but it could be other entities other than sets. In particular, they can be maps, they can be intervals, they can be graphs, and we will see all such examples as we go along. This f was called a flow function or a transfer function. So far we have seen gen and kill that are independent of the argument y. We could have gen and kill that are dependent on the argument y, and we will see some such examples in second module and in particular in the third module. And this confluence operation is something that combines the values of different data flow variables from the neighboring nodes. In some cases, these are the predecessors. In some cases, these are the successors. But there is a way of merging all these values. So far, we have seen set union and set intersection. These could be other operations. In particular, when we have things like intervals or maps or graphs, we will have some other operations. So we'll talk about general properties of these operations. We'll talk about general properties of these values represented by data flow variables. We will need to talk about the general properties of the flow functions. We will do all of this in the second module of the course, which generalizes the concepts we have seen so far and talks about the theoretical abstractions in data flow analysis. So here is a standard taxonomy of Bitvector data flow frameworks. We talk about forward or backward data flow problems. We talked about confluence, which is union or intersection, and we have covered all possible combinations. By union, we say any path or some path problem where the property must hold along some path, not necessarily along all. By intersection, we mean the property must hold along all paths or property must hold along every path. By a forward data flow problem, we mean that the data flow information at a node is influenced by its ancestor nodes. By a backward data flow problem, we mean that a data flow value at a node is influenced by the descendant nodes. And by bidirectional, we mean that the data flow value at a node are influenced by both ancestors as well as descendants. We have not covered this particular bit vector framework called partial redundancy elimination I have removed that from the course, but you should know that there are frameworks where data flow propagation could be both forward as well as backward. So with that, we come to the end of this module on bit vector frameworks. In the next module, which is on theoretical abstractions of data flow analysis, what we will do is we will generalize the observations that we have made, and instead of limiting them to the bit vector frameworks, we will generalize them, define the properties, and come up with the criteria such that we can define any data flow framework of our choice. So we stop here in this module, and we will meet in the next lecture to start looking at generalizations of the concepts that we have seen so far.